Start, ma'am.
Yes, please start.
Good afternoon, everyone. PCOE ISH welcomes you for today's regional distance learning seminar series. Today's topic is infection prevention and control for COVID-19. Today's speaker is Professor Dr. N. Devasena. We welcome you, madam, to take over this session. Thank you. I want to give an introduction. She is currently working as a professor of microbiology department and infection control nodal officer at Institute of Child Health and Hospital for Children since November 2011. She completed her undergraduate from JJM Medical College, Karnataka in 1992 and postgraduate from Madras Medical College in 1999. She also worked as Madras Medical College for 3 years and Stanley Medical College for 1 year as professor of microbiology department. As an associate professor, she worked in Chengalpet Medical College for 2.5 years and Vellore Medical College for 1 year. She has also worked in Kilpak Medical College for 5 years as assistant professor. She has done several publications in national and international journals. I welcome our speaker to take for this session. Thank you.
Thank you for that nice introduction, Anisha. So good morning, everyone. Hope I'm audible to you all.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you. And welcome to all the participants. Now we'll move on to our interesting topic. Regarding infection prevention and control in our hospital setup, in our labs, in our surroundings, and in our nursing homes, clinic, and where all infection prevention is needed. We'll go into the details about that. And I know ART centers and all the caring centers and all the labs especially, they need to be very careful regarding the biosafety of handling themselves as well as their surroundings, as well as the equipment. So it's very important, and you all must have been very careful regarding this, I know, but still we'll have a detailed session on this. So welcome you all to this, and thanks for the opportunity. So we'll move on to the slides. So learning objectives is here, main thing is hospital acquired infection and IPC. So infection preventive control strategies. IPC is infection prevention control strategies for COVID-19. So what are the standard precautions you need to take? What about the triage area? What's the early identification and source of control? Additional precautions, additional control measures, environmental cleaning and disinfection, and biomedical waste management. And you all know the most of the infectious materials handling our COVID-19, all the, starting from your PPE that you're wearing to take samples from the patient, and all the specimens and all the blood collection, and what are the things, test tubes and equipment. So everything has to have some SOP, standard operational program. And then you have to have operational precautions, standard operational precautions. And these are the things you have to know. So healthcare associated infection, the most common adverse effects. We don't touch upon HA now because you have to know it's easily spread because if you are careless regarding your biomedical waste management. But here COVID-19, you can't take chance. You can't spread it to the community. If one patient is tested as COVID positive, you know what are the containment measures you have to have towards all the implementation. So so we have different disciplines and departments which all need our care. And the safety of patients, their families, health workers, and community. So we have to take the utmost prevention and control measures to prevent the spread of infections. Okay, we are not bothered about other infections like tuberculosis or anything. Because, of course, we have to be concerned. But COVID-19 spreads very fast because the incubation period has become very short now. They say between 1 to 14 days. So within a day also it can spread. And each one presents in a different way. And those with comorbid conditions working in hospital environment, they have to take the utmost care also. So next slide. So IPC program includes action plan for strengthening the facility and individual units based on the risk assessment and constitutes an IPC team responsible for day-to-day activities and which has specific guidelines. Organize the training programs for all the staffs and healthcare workers. Yeah. Develop antibiotic policy and antibiotic stewardship program is not needed now in this COVID region, but that is a part of this IPC program. So who are at risk? All at risk. We are at risk. So everyone, anytime, anywhere, we are at risk. Not only the hospital or healthcare workers, the sanitary workers, doctors, nurses, so our paramedics and the families who come to the hospital, everyone is at risk. So everyone, you have to protect yourself, protect your patient, protect your family, community and environment. So to reduce, now we want to talk about COVID-19. So healthcare associated infection, I want to highlight it as COVID-19 infection. So again, to enhance all these things, so what are the goals? Knowledge, you have to have the understanding, the SOP development, assessment, preparedness and readiness, coordinate patient triage is very important. You have to have a triage area where when the patient comes with their attenders, you have to make them sit in a particular area, make them wear their PPE, and all the other things, and then they have to enter, and your PPE also, and how to dispose that is very important. So these are the important ones. So IPC strategies, so the basic about COVID-19. So we are generally talking about all the infection. Now when we think of COVID-19, you know, this is COVID-2019 because the disease started in December 2019. Earlier the disease was presented in the form of SARS and MERS in 2002 and 2012, so you know all that. So this is mainly spread through respiratory droplets, and contact routes are like that. Droplet transmission occurs when a person is in close contact within 1 meter distance, someone who has respiratory symptoms, example, coughing and sneezing. So here coughing is a dry cough is important symptoms in COVID. The risk of having is a mucus, a mouth or nose or conjunctiva exposed to potentially infective respiratory droplets. So we always think we can acquire it through droplets. When there is no human existence near that cough area or the droplet area, the virus settles down, it falls down because of gravity and it cannot multiply further. But if it reaches another human host, it starts multiplying. So that's why we have to maintain at least 2 meter distance. And then apart from wearing your mask and cap, most of the infections can also be carried through our conjunctiva. So you have to wear proper goggles. So and fomite infection. So when you're coughing or sneezing without your mask, your droplet can settle on the surface of the table. Then immediately when someone touches the table and they take the surface contaminant near their nose or mouth, they'll be getting the infection. So fomites can be in the form of table surface or through pen or your stethoscope, or it can be through your thermometer or mobile, or it can be any other objective. So airborne transmission may be possible in specific circumstances in which procedures or support treatments, like when you do all the aerosol procedures, like just like taking a swab or endotracheal incubation and open suctioning, manual ventilation, or when you're doing a tracheostomy, or you know, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, so any intubation, non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. So these are all the invasive procedures. Just asking the patient to open the mouth by keeping a tongue depressor, and if you're going to take the swab, that itself is aerosol generating procedure. So any bronchoscopy, that is also an aerosol generating procedure. You need to be very careful. You have to have a negative suction room, or you have to have a separate area for that. And you have to wear your PPE, and you have to dispose your PPE in yellow color cover and bin. So applying the standard precautions for all patients at all times is very important. And ensuring triage, early recognition, source control. So if you doubt when a patient is coming for a particular treatment or diagnosis, and if you have a doubt that he is going to be COVID positive, you isolate there itself. Because in that waiting area and in the reception area, he has the capacity to spread the infection to others. So you have to, if you suspect that triage area means the area which is meant to separate the COVID suspects from non-COVID suspects. So that is a triage area. Implementing administrative controls. In the sense, you have to have sufficient manpower to divert this COVID suspect individual to some separate area. Triage is just a separate area where I have to take swabs for them or consider them as COVID positive patients. and implementing environmental and engineering controls. Say environmental in the sense when these patients are seated in a particular area among all the common people, you have to make them sit at 6 feet. I mean, 6 feet distance, and then you have to make sure they are wearing masks, and you have to give them hand wash solution or scrub, and these things have to be followed even before they enter the triage area or into the consultation area or into the main hospital isolation area. So these are the standard precautions. The basic level you have to follow, and the risk assessment for all such activities, you have to have your PPE, that is adequate protection by PPE. So when we say standard precautions that you have to follow, first one is hand hygiene. You can use soap water. You know, this virus has got a lipid layer. And when you wash your hands with soap water, this lipid layer is being destroyed, and immediately the virus becomes inactive, inability to multiply. So that soap solution is not available, soap and water is not available, then you use a 70% alcohol based hand rub. Then respiratory hygiene, cough etiquette. The person cannot cough just like that, he has to cough within his elbow. That way he will not spread the droplets. And PPE according to the risk. So many of the hospital workers, they need to wear cap, mask and the goggles, I would suggest, and also gloves wherever needed. But they need not wear the entire PPE gown or the shoes and shoe covers all the time. PPE in a full with N95 mask is needed, where you have to have this generation of aerosol procedures if you suspect like bronchoscopy or in OT theater, you know, then where you take your swabs for testing. So there all you have to be careful. So safe handling, sharps management, safe injection practices also to be followed, as we follow regularly in our infection control practices. And then cleaning and disinfection of patient care equipment is important. Equipment can be as small as a thermometer or stethoscope to bigger equipment. So even the stethoscope, base of the stethoscope need to be cleaned with a hand rub solution. And the thermometer also need to be cleaned. Environmental cleaning is a must. With actually 5% Lysol, they say that's the best. And some areas you can use 1% sodium hypochlorite solution to clean the surfaces. And soiled linen. If you suspect the patient has COVID-19, the linen has to be disposed completely in yellow color bin or cover. I mean yellow color cover, and then all the waste management as you follow. But most of the COVID-19 samples are being disposed in yellow color cover and bin. So the chain of transmission from the infectious agent, the mode of transmission, portal of exit, that you know for COVID-19. The best way to prevent the spread of germs, not only COVID-19, generally also, is to wash our hands properly. And our hands are main tool for work. See, actually we have to heal with our hands, but we cannot harm the healthy individual. So you when you come to the suspicion of the door handles, we tend to, you know, open with our bare hands. There they can, it can be a fomite infection. And when a healthy individual touches that, the secretions of COVID-19 patient can enter him. So the door handles need to be sterilized again or disinfected with 5% Lysol, and that looks too much. So 1% sodium hypochlorite solution or even hand solution or butyraldehyde or acidic solution is enough to clean the door handles. And instruments, the base of the stethoscope, I said you need to clean with your hand rub solution. And the wire of the stethoscope has to be rubbed with the cotton, which is soaked in 1% sodium hypochlorite solution. And your mobiles are the greatest source of infection. It has to be cleaned with your hand rub solution. And the caregivers, they have to be taken care, and you have to know what all the surfaces they have touched, and you have to keep them safe. This all the participants, are you able to hear me? Hello?
Ma'am, you're audible.
Because I'm going on. Yeah. Am I audible? Yeah,
yes, thank you. Yes.
Am I audible, and is my voice clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. So the 5 moments of hand hygiene as recommended by WHO, we have to follow that. But there are 8 important steps, but you have to follow these 5 important moments. So before touching a patient, before cleaning or doing a septic procedure, and after touching a patient, after the body fluid exposure is, and after touching patient surroundings. So these are the 5 important moments you have to take care, and 8 steps are there in hand washing. That's different. So hand hygiene, how to wash your hands. So this picture clearly depicts the steps. So when you press when you're using your hand rub, the way you have to press the bottle is also very important. So hand washing technique with soap and water, that's the easier and simplest one. So you get the soap solution and you have to palm to palm, you have to rub. Then the second step will be like interdigital space. And the third one will be like you have to scrub your nails in the palm. And the fourth one will be like you have to, you know, wipe thumb, I mean wash your thumb. And then again, you have to do the palm, the backside dorsal aspect of your palm also had to be rubbed and clean. Then you can go to your elbow also if you feel they had to be clean. So these are the main steps of hand washing. It's normally when you wash it with soap and water, it takes about 40 to 60 seconds. It's the ideal method. And alcohol-based hand rub when tap is running, when tap water and running water is not available, and soap is not available, then you have to go for alcohol-based hand rub. And that takes about 20 to 30 seconds. So they normally say you have to sing a song like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, and if you wash your hands, it takes about 40 to 60 seconds. So when your hands are visibly dirty, then please use only soap, running water, and a fresh sterile towel. Otherwise, if it's not visibly dirty, soap is not available, then you can use your alcohol-based hand rub. So, duration of the entire procedure, you can see when they are visibly soiled, the duration of the 20 to 30 seconds, and when you use a starter, when you use water, it's 40 seconds. Washing with soap and water, I suggest, is the best method. Only when it's not available, use your hand. So, respiratory cough fatigue. So, 90% of the infection is spread only through coughing. So, because the droplets are spread very easily, it spreads through droplets very easily. And that's the best mode of transmission according to this thing. And aerosol, these two are the major modes of transmission. So, when person the signs and symptoms of respiratory infection comes to you or the clinic or in your surroundings, ask them to cover their nose and mouth with tissue while coughing or sneezing, and they should dispose the tissue in the available bin, preferably in the yellow colored bag and bin. Perform hand hygiene after contact with respiratory secretions, contaminated objects or materials. So in absence of tissue or handkerchief, patients should be instructed to cover their nose and mouth with arm, with elbows, with cough etiquette. And spitting is should be clearly avoided, because we are very famous for spitting in India. We have spread tuberculosis, but this spreads very fast if you keep spitting, because the droplets, I don't know, can enter anyone in a very easy manner. So ensure the availability of materials for cough etiquette also. So all these things, if you provide them, and patients and people, if they are aware, they'll not be spreading. So this containment of respiratory spread, we have to follow. And these are the detailed instructions regarding that. So these are the important types of our PPE. Face masks, you have surgical masks, you have triple layer masks, right? And then the N95 masks, you know, it's very important. It filters almost 95% of the viruses. And face shield is also important, so your conjunctiva is protected. Goggles are also important to prevent infection to conjunctiva. And your gown should be completely covering your scrub or whatever dress you are going to wear. And apron and the gloves should be well fitting and of good texture. Head cover is very important, because even through hair it can spread. And shoe covers that completes your PPE. And shoe covers are very, very important. You won't know how you're going to carry the germs. These are the important PPE that have been used and it's going to be used. And so select PPE. So you require different types of PPE based on the exposure you're going to have with the patient. So risk of exposure, if you're going to come into contact with the blood or body fluids or respiratory droplets, then you select which PPE items to wear. Perform hand hygiene. So before wearing the PPE and after wearing the PPE, again hand hygiene should be performed. So direct exposure scenario, always before and after patient contact and after contaminated environment, hand hygiene is a must. Gloves also if you are coming in contact with the body fluids or secretions. And if there's risk of splashes, then hand hygiene, gloves and gown are important. If there is the body and face, you have to wear your eyewear. So you have to have hand hygiene, gloves, wear your gown, medical mask is a must, and then eyewear and like goggles is a must. So always perform hand hygiene before and after PPE, as I said. And then always put PPE on before contact with the patient. and wear the correct size according to the risk you choose the PPE. Remove the PPE immediately after completing the task. You know, you cannot be loitering around the PPE after you have completed the procedure with the patient, because again you are spreading the infection to the community. So again, never use the disposable PPE. PPE is so costly. So if you use it again, that is a foolishness. So once you use the PPE, please discard it into the yellow color cover and bin. So clean and disinfect reusable PPE between the procedures. So you cannot change the PPE immediately if it becomes soiled or contaminated or damaged, but you have to change. Because once if you change only, then you are not contaminating yourself or the patient or the community. So change your PPE immediately and take time to wear another PPE. PPE should not be adjusted or touched during patient care. And when you are going in a ward with your PPE, and if you are examining a patient and if you are going to touch yourself and adjusting, that's not the correct way, you are spreading infection. So never touch your face while wearing PPE. If there is concern or breach of these practices, leave the patient care area and you properly remove and change the PPE. Always remove PPEs, remove carefully to avoid self-contamination first. And from the deep, so you know the donning and doffing of PPE, right? So when you want to remove your PPE, please remove PPE from the dirtiest to cleanest area. In the sense, you have to remove your gloves first. So gloves is the most contaminated thing. But when you are wearing your PPE, you have to wear your gloves in the end. But when you are removing, you have to remove your gloves first. Then you have to remove your shoe covers. Then you have to remove your cap. Then mask. Then gown. In the end only, goggles. In the end, you have to remove your mask. Because this N95 mask is the last one to be removed, and that gives you complete protection. Because while removing your shoe covers or goggles, you are still having the splash on you. So first thing is to be removed is your gloves. The last thing to be removed is your mask. So this is how you have to wear this type of PPE. You know, you have to choose your impervious gown. So fully, how to wear this gown, fully covered torso from neck to knees. And then it has to have a fasten in back or neck or waist. And mask or respirator, secure ties or elastic bands. Please wear your mask properly, goggles or face shield and the gloves. But then how to safely remove? They have removed the gloves first, goggles or face shield second, gown, mask or respirator, and wash your hands. So there's no area where they have mentioned about the footwear. So after removing the gloves, you can remove your footwear also. So 7 steps to safe injection practices. Clean workspace. Hand hygiene is important. Sterile safety engineering syringe is important. Sterile vial. Skin cleaning and antiseptics. Appropriate collection of sharps. Appropriate waste management. So we have talked about COVID-19 as such. What are the PPEs to be worn regarding the donning and doffing? Donning, in the sense, which is the first one to be worn? You have to wear your, after your hand rub or hand, you have to wear first. And then you have to wear your shoe covers. Then you have to wear your cap. Then mask. Then goggles. At the end only, you have to wear your gloves. The removing will be in the opposite direction. So triage area, early. This is very important of today's topic, triaging. The timely and effective triage and admit patients to dedicated area. That's very important. And use triage in all healthcare facilities to early identification and acute respiratory infection prevention, so that we can protect ourselves and other healthcare workers. So first of all, when you have this entry of patients into your hospital, triage is nothing but isolating according to the, when they come as OP. OP, they're coming as OP patients, outpatients. So you know you have to have a dedicated area where you suspect the patient with COVID symptoms and non-COVID. So prevent overcrowding, conduct rapid triage. Family members should wait outside the triage area. So only the patient should be admitted inside the triage area. When they come as OP, you know, we cannot make the entire family get into that area. Place ARI patients in the dedicated acute respiratory tract infection patients in dedicated waiting area. Ask patients with respiratory symptoms to wear face masks, follow the respiratory and hand hygiene, very, very important. Ensure at least 1 meter distance between patient. I would suggest 2 meters distance or 6 feet distance. Maintain a one-way flow of patients and staff. You know, they cannot be just loitering around. So, and you have to take care of the materials around them. The equipment in triage area, you have the, you know, you have infrared cup. thermometer, waist bin, signage, all those things, and hand hygiene equipment, documentation papers, PPE, IEC materials. So these are the algorithm for triad, screening questionnaire. So all these things you have to maintain in triage area. So when we admit, do not place suspect or confirm COVID-19 in the same area ward as those are confirmed. So I told you earlier, just to have a suspect area and you have to put the suspected people there. So screening, isolation and triage is a must. And then hub and spoke model. So there will be need for multiple treatment areas. So this is called hub and spoke model. And screening and triage, you can have the ambulance area, then when you are receiving the patient, acuity-based triage, then you have to isolate, test it. And when you are taking the swabs for testing, till the result comes, they have to be isolated in a particular area. Positive ones have to be in a separate area. So after triage, the screening, and then there is admission. So this is the hub and spoke model. So what are the additional precautions you know? So right from the droplet infection for all suspected and confirmed COVID-19 patients, only for aerosol generating procedures, you have to have extreme precautions for that. That is open suctioning, intubation, bronchoscopy, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, etc. Preferably, patient should be in a single room to ventilation with airflow of at least 160 liters per second is needed. Negative pressure rooms we suggest always, 12 air changes, especially for these aerosol generating procedures and for the operation theaters. And the cohort, all patients with respiratory illness should be in a single room and 1 meter away from other patients. The dedicated and trained healthcare workers, we have to take classes for these people and train healthcare workers to wear PPE always, at least wear a medical mask, goggles, a face shield, gowns and gloves. And hand hygiene, of course, Vito spoke about that. So equipment should be single use when possible. It should be dedicated to each patient and have patients. Patients should wear mask also. That's very important. Please limit the number of healthcare workers, visitors, and family members who are in contact with the patient. So everyone must wear PPE based on the risk, and precautions should continue until the patient is discharged. Even when you wear PPE, the patient needs to wear. So the basic principles of infection control practices and standard precautions will be like triage and early recognition, emphasis on respiratory and hand hygiene, medical masks to use by patients with respiratory symptoms, place patients in separate rooms or away from other patients in the waiting rooms. When symptomatic patients are required to wait, ensure they have a separate waiting area also. So these things only we had discussed so far in the previous slide. Additional control measures, so elimination, substitution, engineering controls, administrative controls, PPE. So protect the worker with PPE, change the way people work, isolate people from the hazard and replace the hazard, physically remove the hazard. So these are the controls. So home care of patient with suspected COVID-19. So far we saw how to take care of patient when they are coming inpatient. And when we have the OP patient. Now, if they need home quarantine, and then we have to have place patients in a well-ventilated single room, limit the movement of the patient and minimize shared space. They should have well-ventilated windows and doors. Household members should stay in a different room, okay, and limit the number of caregivers. So at least they should stay 1 meter from the ill person. They should not come in contact with the person. Visitors should not be allowed from outside. And hand hygiene before and after preparing food and touching the toilet, they're using it to common contain respiratory secretions, and they had to wear a mask when handling these patients. So individuals who cannot tolerate a medical mask should use rigorous respiratory hygiene. So avoid contact with the body fluids, use disposable gloves. All these linen and utensils used by the patient, again, they have to be, washed with the detergent. Soap and detergent water is more than enough. Clean and disinfect daily surfaces and household soap or detergent for flooring, rinsing. So with 0.1% sodium hypochlorite for flooring, cleaning the floor is also recommended. And use a face mask limit spread of respiratory disease. What you are doing in the hospital, same thing. If the patient is home quarantined, you have to follow the same thing. I mean, the attenders are the people with the patient. So individuals without respiratory symptoms, this is like in a community setting. Avoid close crowd spaces. Maintain distance 1 meter. Practice hand and respiratory hygiene. refrain from touching your face, nose and mouth. So individuals with respiratory symptoms need to wear a surgical mask, seek medical care and learn. Why do individuals with respiratory system should wear a surgical mask? So that they had to prevent the spread of infection. So home-based care regarding this mask wearing is important, and along with the hand hygiene. And these are the N95 researchers. But, and they had to be a certified, they use a particular respirator, N95, NIOSH certified and all those things. See, these masks also, you should know how to use, and you should not keep touching the mask. And replace masks, the new clean masks, as soon as they become wet. Do not use the same mask again daily. And the most important part of today's program is environmental cleaning and disinfection. So, general principles you have to follow regarding this. So, maybe microbiological contaminated surfaces will be a source of infection or mites. So we have to keep in our mind. And COVID-19 virus can potentially survive the environment for several hours or days. They say in the surfaces, wooden surfaces, it can survive from 12 to 16 hours. Whereas in the leather on your shoes or, on your screens, they can survive for 48 hours. So you have to know the possible contaminated materials around you. Products containing antimicrobial agents to be used. Established cleaning strategies to be followed. Remove the majority of bioburden. Disinfect all the equipment and environmental surface. So housekeeping surfaces can be divided into two groups. Those with minimal hand contact. Example, floors and ceilings, you're not going to touch with your hand, so minimal. High-touch surfaces, those with frequent hand contact. Like, what are the high touches? Door knobs, bed rails, light switches, the areas on the toilet, the patient's room. So these are the main source of spread. So you have to clean these areas with disinfectants. So where you're cleaning and disinfection, wear gloves when handling and transporting the equipment or any instrument handled by the patient. Before removing equipment from patient's room, medical equipment must be disinfected. So usually only require cleansing followed by low to intermediate level disinfection. I told you, you are in a clinic or the hospital, your equipment to be sterilized will be stethoscopes, BP apparatus, equipment knobs and control. So 70% isopropyl alcohol is used to disinfect your rubber toppers, thermometers and stethoscope and ventilators. Alcohol causes discoloration, so we prevent that. Difficult to clean surfaces and equipment again, your mattresses, remove the discard coverings from gloves, hands, perform hand hygiene, all those things. So this chart is very important. Stethoscope, alcohol-based rubber spirit swab, so it should be clean, detergent and water, it should be wiped with alcohol. The detergent you cannot pour on the stethoscope or BP. So you have to soak cotton in this disinfectant and clean. Cuff should be wiped again with alcohol-based disinfectant. Thermometer with disinfectant like detergent and water. And your injection and dressing trolley also either 70% alcohol or detergent and water. So these beddings are again, we have to be very careful. Use a 70% ethyl alcohol for small areas and sodium hypochlorite solution. And then all the soil linen, all those things have to be kept in a leak-proof bag or bucket. And put it in your yellow color, dispose in yellow color cover and perform the hand hygiene. So you can follow the laundry or can use it separately for each patient, or you can just discard. At home, you can reuse this laundry method. So we have special trained professionals to keep your environment clean by using PPE, and you have a checklist and you have to do it on a periodically daily basis. So housekeeping surfaces are important also, and eating utensils, yes. And when there's a spill, again you have to be careful. Spill can also be a bronchial lavage or a blood spill or your cough droplets. Visible. So use disinfectant 1% for small spills and 10% for large spills. You have to put a gauze or a cotton over that. You have to wait for half an hour, and then that will be the contact period. And you have to slowly remove that and put it in your yellow color cover and bin. cleaning and disinfection of the patient discharge and transfer also is important. So biomedical waste management generally know, but regarding this COVID-19 infection and its control, a few lines on that, but very important. So this Biomedical Rules Act, you know, when it came into act, the Environmental Protection Act also came in 1986. But more so during COVID, we had to apply all those things. So yellow bag is for your anatomical waste, human, animal, body parts and tissue. Now you must be thinking this COVID-19 droplets or their, you know, sputum and, you know, just cough material or your even blood and all these things will be like, you have to consider it as waste. So human biological waste, everything into your cover and the bag. Even the PPE material, we also feel it has come in contact with the droplet. That's why the PPE, entire PPE, we're discarding into your yellow color cover and bin. So the laboratory cultures, normally it goes to yellow bag that you know. And lastly, discarded linen, contaminated blood or body fluids here is droplets. So including mask and gown, again it should go into yellow bag. So here it is, normally you know all the plastic ones and tubing and bottles, IV sets, catheters go into the red bag along with the petri dishes from microbiology lab. But here, what do you think should go into the red bag? Everything has gone into the yellow. Probably if you have a plastic footwear, but that's also contaminated, we prefer it in yellow. But and probably the inner gloves that you're wearing, the outer gloves, you have to throw it in yellow because it's soiled with the body fluids. The inner gloves should go into the red bag, maybe if it is not contaminated. And I would suggest these goggles, if they are not contaminated with droplets, if you feel there's no aerosol in that or droplet in that, then you can put it in the red. But still, preferably, if you are doubting, you put it in the yellow color cover and bag. So you always know where to destroy your needles. A needle destroyer, a hub cutter is better. And you have a translucent white box where you have to place it. A blue box is again a puncture proof, or you can have a cardboard rather. Because, and here you have to have your broken vials and cytotoxic. So normally we say cytotoxic waste also into yellow, but some of the, you know, like glass waste, which you feel cytotoxic waste is being contaminated with, then you can put it in a puncture proof container, blue bag. So labeling of the biomedical waste is important. You have to write, this is the COVID, like we have GG multiclave, taking into the common treatment. Now COVID biomedical waste. It says it's a COVID biomedical waste. You have to tell them, weigh them separately, apart from your regular biomedical waste, and you have to have a register and you have to report it. So you know, a color bag is a non-coded, a color-coded bag. So you know the waste that are going to be discarded in that treatment or disposable is by incineration or debarking. Red is uncoated plastic bag. Treatment of disposal is by, you know, autoclaving or debarking. Not debarking. Incineration debarking is for yellow. For red is mainly by autoclaving. And then for white, translucent puncture proof container, waste shards including the metals, you have to have that autoclaving and drying heat sterilization or mutilation. And blue box, waterproof cardboard ones, the glassware, broken glassware and waste, and disinfection are by micro or hydro. Then it has to be sent for recycling. But normally what we do is mutilation again. So COVID-19 isolation, how it has to follow the biomedical waste is very important. And you have to post all the biomedical waste management signages. And as precaution, double eight bags, using two bags should be used for collection of waste from COVID-19 wards. So why? Because we cannot have waste up the same and use the other waste and hand out the sensor van comes. So you have two different one COVID on COVID waste. In addition to mandatory labeling is very important as COVID-19 waste. So they will be very careful in handling and discarding the waste. Maintain separate record, as I told you, and general waste not having contamination treatment issues. So conclusions, the IPC is a key for quality management, and based on the principles, hand hygiene, restricted etiquette, and droplet precautions is a must. And hospital, I told you how to use a disinfectant, surroundings, keep the surroundings clean, environment, protect yourself with PPE. So triage of OPD patients and judicious use of PPE and appropriate use. So pay attention to your donning and doffing. How you wear the PPE is also important, the order of wearing. And how do you dispose of doffing? How do you start removing from the dirtiest area to the cleanest area? Doffing is important. And if you are home isolated, you have home triage area and home isolation or home quarantine, those home care precautions are to be followed also. And the next conclusion is cleaning and disinfecting environmental surfaces. I told you, so you have to reduce the healthcare associated infections. So established cleaning strategies to be followed. Clean staff must be protected by use of standard precautions. Manage biomedical waste as per the biomedical waste rules and guidelines. So again, this is the most essential take home message. Wash your hands with soap and running water when hands are visibly dirty, because if this RNA virus is a lipid layer virus, and this lipid layer will be easily destroyed by soap and water, and you won't be spreading the infection if you are, you know, and avoid handshaking and social distance. Distancing, wear your masks, all those things are important. And your labs or in ART centers. If you have fever, cough, and difficulty in breathing, seek medical advice immediately, because this COVID-19 usually presents with fever, cough, and shortness of breath can come on the 7th day. You know, the incubation period is 2 to 14 days. You can have fever and cough in the initial 5 days, but after 5 days, 5 to 10 days, the most dangerous when you can have shortness of breath. You are giving it earlier. People who came from USA or China or Italy and you know other UK countries and all those things, they had history of travel. Immediately they were spreading the disease, so they had to give a complete history of travel. Now everywhere the disease is almost in all the countries. So you stay protected, you stay safe from coronavirus. So reduce this risk of infection by following all these things, you know. All the precautions that we see. And wherever you are, you know, you have to often and before coughing and sneezing, please wash your hands. That's most important. So they have, you know, represented in the photographic forms. So these are the things which from where we got all the details. So hope you all followed my class, and you please follow your hand washing techniques properly and your wearing of PPE. And isolating yourself from COVID positive patient, and make sure you don't spread the infection in the community. Take classes for all this. Your technicians, your lab people, lab attendants, and even the those who, you know, those healthcare workers, all the healthcare workers, and the public education is also very important by signages and other things. So thank you. And if you have any doubts, please ask me regarding this. So hope you had a, thanks for your patient listening. I should thank you, because I was continuously talking, and I'd like to know who all participated, and thanks a lot for your patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the informative sessions. Participants can now unmute themselves and ask questions.
Yeah, sure.
Participants, if you have any questions, please unmute yourself or you can type in the chat box. Any questions?
Okay. Participant have any questions? Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this informative session. This is very useful for us to improve our safety precaution in this pandemic period. Thanks to all the participants for the active listening. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.